Today is Monday the 9th of November, and this is a Labour Lives interview. And I'm lucky enough to be interviewing Councillor Claire Spencer, the councillor for Moseley and Kingsheath in Birmingham. Thank you for coming, Councillor Spencer.
Thank you for having me.
You were elected as a councillor in May 2014. But what I'm kind of interested in is taking you a little back before then. So tell us something about who Councillor Spencer is, where she comes from, and what else you want to tell us about how you came to be a member of the Labour Party and subsequently a councillor in Birmingham.
Okay. I'll take you right back to the beginning, because I think, you know, as it often does, that does have relevance to where I've ended up, even if I couldn't quite see it at the time. So I was born in Barrow in Furness, which, for those of you who don't know, is in Cumbria. My dad is from Ulverston in Cumbria. I was born in the same hospital, on the same ward as him. But similarities ended there. My mum, in fact, is from Iraq. And mum and dad met when dad was working in Iraq as a civil engineer. And she worked for him, and they fell in love and farcically got married after 3 months, which is a sort of terrifying state of affairs as far as I'm concerned. But it seems to have been a good decision. They're still together now. But mum moved to England to be with dad and to ultimately raise me and my brothers, which is, obviously I'm very, very grateful for. But I think the thing that I wanted to highlight from childhood is that I had a really quite nice life. We grew up in Bath. You know, we weren't super rich, but obviously living in Bath in a, you know, 3-bedroom house, never went hungry, never felt that you couldn't go on school trips. And as I grew older and kind of got more interested in the lives my parents had before me, you kind of slowly dawns on you that those advantages didn't necessarily exist for them. I mean, education in its own right was a great and precious gift to my mum, and, you know, something that I had taken for granted that she never had. You know, education was the key to everything in Iraq. You know, it was a difference between living a life of kind of low status and penury and, you know, having the world slightly open up for you, and being a young woman, not a Muslim woman, in Iraq as well. You know, she had to face quite a lot of injustices and quite a lot of things that I've just not had in my life. And, you know, on dad's side, even though he hasn't had quite such the dramatic backstory as growing up in Cumbria, actually still working class family, first in his family to go to university, probably wouldn't have ended up there had he not got into a grammar school. So all these things start stacking up in your brain as you grow older, and once you get through the teenage, like I was quite a, like many teenagers are, quite self-centered, and, you know, once you kind of get out of that period of your life and you start thinking, you know, actually, you know, chance of birth, you know, you've ended up living what is quite a comfortable life, and like any number of these things could have changed and you could be living a very different life that is much, much harder on you, and actually you should give something back. So eventually, you know, I did start giving something back. Once I got through university, sort of settled into a career job, just felt that actually you've thought about yourself enough now, you know.
But one of the things that couldn't have escaped you surely at university was the Iraq War.
No. And it was strange in a way, because I think I'd been, when you've grown up with an Iraqi mum, you haven't really escaped from the sort of violence of her history. And a lot of my mum's personal history has been marked by conflicts of one sort or another. So, you know, when she was probably about 4, her whole family had to flee Aradan, which is a village in the north of Iraq, because, you know, she is a Chaldean, like, you know, a family of Chaldean Catholics. There was so much tension between them and the Kurdish population that the violence was just putting them all at terrible risk. You know, you had a situation where, you know, my mum was being, her sisters would throw her out the back window of the house to escape from gunmen who were breaking in the front, and my granddad would sit there holding a shotgun facing the door. And, you know, even though my mum never saw any of this because she was a kid who'd been thrown out the back window, actually, the distinct vibe was anyone who's coming through that door is getting killed, because that was the sort of world it was. And I think he just didn't want that for his family anymore. So they you know, they walked over the mountains, the kids not having any shoes, you know, with a donkey. It was really, like, ridiculously biblical. You know, they walked to Baghdad, which was a very liberal place to live in Iraq. You know, there was a lot of people, and unlike nowadays, nobody cared if you were Sunni, Shia, Jewish, Christian. You know, there were certain consequences to not being in line with the ruling party, but actually people kind of rubbed along and didn't really care. And so it was a much better place to grow up for you know, for my mum and her sisters and her brother. But then the Iran-Iraq war came as well, which would have been around the time that my dad was there in Iraq. Mum tells one story where I think dad stood on the roof of her house as the planes were flying over and the shotgun shells were landing on the roof and, like, on his shoulders and stuff like that. And mum was standing there going, "What are you doing, you crazy man? Get off the house." But for a lad from, you know, Ulverston, a market town in Cumbria, this was the most remarkable thing he'd ever seen, you know. And it's like, yeah, dad, I really, you know, quite glad that didn't go any worse for you, to be honest. But yeah, so there was that. They moved, mum obviously moved then, but then there was the first Gulf War, and it was during that war that a couple more of my mum's sisters moved over to England. So my auntie Katrina and my auntie Khawa moved
over. And did they come as refugees or what?
They did come as refugees, yeah. So obviously, well, not obviously, but it is easier to have somewhere, you know, become a refugee somewhere when you've got family there, basically, and just purely because they can make arrangements for you to come and stay with them while you get everything else sorted out. And obviously they will provide, you know, we would financially support my auntie Catherine, who lived with us in Bath in our house for, like, the first few months while she got a, you know, a council place sorted. And, you know, she lived in a bed and breakfast for a bit, a hostel for a bit, and then eventually got a council flat in Bath.
Okay, well, one of the things I asked you earlier on was that, and when you told me about your Iraqi family, or your Iraqi mum, and all the family that you have, who are now, as I understand it, kind of scattered across the world, really.
Yeah.
Is that in your second year at university, the Labour Party
went to war. Yes, sorry, yeah.
So did that kind of have any effect on you?
I mean, it had obviously very practical effects, so that, you know, Iraq became too dangerous for my very elderly grandmother to live in. So my parents travelled to Jordan, and my uncle drove my grandmother across the border into Jordan, and my parents took her home to, you know, the UK, obviously, like, must be a very kind of, considering, I mean, she was in her 80s at the time and is obviously older now. You know, it was a very, it must be a huge amount of upheaval for somebody at that time of their life. So there was that side of it. But to be honest, my feelings around it were always a bit more complicated because, you know, on the one hand, I knew that, you know, in some ways, Saddam Hussein had been the lesser of probably several other evils. I mean, from my mum's accounts, I know that, for example, his sons, you know, were they to get a sniff of power, I think it would have been a lot worse, particularly for Christian people in Iraq, had they, you know, been in power instead of their father. It's also really strange because obviously my mum had had a very complicated relationship with the Kurdish people. And so from a personal perspective, it was like, you know, she found it as hard to be angry about their persecution as other people would, because she had been persecuted by them. You know, she had had Kurdish men wielding guns trying to rob their house and trying to kill them. So for, you know, quite, you know, understandable reasons, she couldn't feel as angry about them being poisoned, even though you could talk to her logically about it. And, you know, she would obviously say, no, that's not okay. But, you know, but I don't think, I mean, they didn't seem, my family didn't seem angry about the war. And I know that my aunties, who are still, and, you know, one of whom is still in Iraq, but, you know, they would make breakfast for the American soldiers. You know, they would show them kindness, because a lot of them are just lads, aren't they? You know, they are very young men, and that maternal instinct didn't really go away from my aunties, just because, and they're a very, you know, when people show hospitality in Iraq, it's always very food-led. You know, they always cook, you know, as you have tonight, like, more food than you need, because my mum would always feel be filled with a deeper shame if you don't cook in, like, more than enough, because then it just shows you're being stingy. Whereas if you cook more than enough, and it's like, you are truly welcome and you can eat as much as you like, and I'm not trying to, you know. So they seem to show that sort of hospitality to the American soldiers. So while it was happening, I mean, that's the sort of account I was getting, also alongside all the, oh, you know, they've bombed this, you know, marketplace, and this has happened and this has happened. So, you know, I don't think I definitely wasn't pleased about the war in Iraq, but I didn't have such a kind of black and white feeling about it, really. I think, you know, it was a dictatorship, and, you know, and I think all of my relatives acknowledged that that had, you know, that was problematic, but also it was a dictatorship under which people had quite normal lives as well. People had businesses and jobs and could go to school, and within certain very tight framework could lead what appeared to be quite a nice life, or at least an all right life. And I think we, as a, you know, invading force, just deeply underestimated what that means to people to have that stability.
We've said you got elected in 2014,
yeah.
But before then, we've got 2005 graduating.
Mm-hmm.
You eventually get a job, which is, you know, you've mm-hmm. described in fingers the career or whatever it happens
yeah.
to be.
Yeah.
What is that? What are the things that are getting you going at that stage? What's getting Claire Spencer going at that stage?
When I get that job?
Yeah. And what is that job?
Well, it is a job working for what was called a financial intelligence magazine. So it's the sort of magazine that CEOs and, you know, mergers and acquisitions lawyers and, you know, CFOs and all those sorts of peoples will, you know, they will be quoted in there, they will write paid for articles, and they will have it on their coffee table to show people how very smart and insightful they are. And I wrote for that magazine for 3 years. That was in my kind of aim to, you know, become a writer, and, you know, I was really pleased to have got the job, and to do them their dues, you know, hiring people who had very, you know, I had very limited writing experience. I'd done some freelance bits for the BBC and, you know, done music reviews and things like that, but never financial intelligence. But, you know, hello.
Had you written for Red Brick at all whilst you were at university?
I hadn't written for Red Brick. It seems like a terrible oversight, doesn't it?
I wonder why you hadn't done that.
Well, I think at one point I did go and, you know, make inquiries about doing that, but it never, to be honest, I can't remember why it didn't come to fruition. I did have a show on Burn FM briefly, although that was obviously dreadful, and it didn't help that my friend Sally and I have very similar sounding voices on tape, so occasionally it sounded like one very overexcitable girl talking to herself in a studio, which is, you know, not ideal in radio land. I think it kind of all came off as quite distracting, but thankfully no one listens to Burn FM unless you happen to be sitting in Joe's bar at the time, so that was something at least. But yeah, at that time, and I've, you know, said this to you before, not on tape, but as I, you know, got to write about more, you know, financial tips and, you know, ways of operating in different emerging markets and virtual data rooms and due diligence and all these sorts of things, I kind of slowly realised, and, it, you know, I wasn't writing things I disagreed with all the time. Sometimes things were just common sense or statements of fact, you know, such as, it's easier to do due diligence overseas when you use a virtual data room, etc. You know, that's not a particularly controversial statement, but, you know, when you're talking about investing in Latin America and saying that labour is cheaper because people are ununionised, you know, because they're scared of being murdered or are being murdered, I found that a bit kind of harder, as a sort of, like, I don't feel like I should casually be saying that this is why it's cheap and good to invest in. It's like, that feels like it's not a good thing. And so eventually I started to think, okay, you know, you're doing all right now. I mean, I was not earning much money at all, you know, probably a hearty £15,000 at that time. But I thought, you know what, you know, you're on the road, maybe you should start giving something back. And so this was around early 2009, which was a very unfashionable time to join the Labour Party. So, you know, you've got me proper if I joined at the absolute nadir. Although I shouldn't say that, really. We could have worse to come. But let's say it was the absolute nadir. So I joined in 2009. At the same time, I also looked for things to do in Moseley, where I was living at the time, and found Moseley Forum by Googling, and so just rocked up to one of their meetings. And I think they must have thought Christmas had come early. Like, I know now when new people come to community meetings, you're like, I'm so pleased. Like, will you be secretary? You're just kind of like, do they have such a high opinion of my abilities? But really, just like, oh my God, it's a new person that doesn't know that being secretary is incredibly difficult. Quick, let's just get them in. So yeah, that's what I started to do, you know, started to do then, really, just to get more involved and to give something back. And I don't know why I seized upon the Labour Party particularly, actually, as a way of getting something back. I had been reading a blog called Boris Watch. Sadly, the author of whom has recently passed away, actually, which is very, very tragic. But I'd been reading his blog, which I'd found on Twitter, and he was obviously keeping an eye on Boris as in the London mayoralty. And you know, I think, you know, or at least in the run-up to becoming Mayor of London as well. And I think that had started to think, you know, oh, you know, he's not doing such a good job. He's making all of these promises. You know, he's, you know, doing all these crazy things around transport, which I don't agree with. And it was slowly building up my knowledge of how these things work, because I really did know very little. And so I thought, yeah, the Labour Party maybe is the vehicle that I want to choose. It feels like it's...
So it wasn't... some sort of love at first sight with the Labour Party?
I mean, I voted Labour in 2005, so, you know, I think it had been I'd known that that's roughly where my politics were, but I don't think... I wasn't tribally there, you know, and I'm sure if I'd been living in Bath, you know, before, maybe I would have made quite a pragmatic decision to, under our horrible first-past-the-post system, to vote Liberal Democrat to keep the Tories out, as so many somewhat lefty people do in Bath, you know. And I think it's only since I have become more involved in Labour that my parents have started voting Labour in Bath, you know, which is more to their politics as well. But actually, I think they were always pragmatic, if not very enthusiastic, Lib Dem voters. You know, I'd always hear my dad grumpily going on about how he'd seen Don Foster at the tip again. And he was like, I wonder why I keep seeing him there. Just like, don't know, Dad. I don't think there was a love at first sight thing. And in fact, I think my first CLP meeting was like deeply strange as well, which you know, luckily I stick to things, otherwise it might have put anybody off. But I think there was about six people in the room, which I was a bit kind of like, oh right, I thought there'd be more people, but never mind. And a gentleman whose name I won't say because he's definitely still around went, oh, this is great that you've turned up because you're young and you're a woman. And you're like, this is pretty much before he'd said hello to me. And I was like, yeah, I guess. You're thinking, is this how people talk to one another in the Labour Party? This is really strange. But, you know, happily having, as I said, spoke to Richard Angel on the phone to say, you know, what should I do? And he said, oh, well, you know, where are you in the party? And I was like, left. And he's like, well, it's all left, but you know, which bit left? I was like, to be honest, I really don't know. So I joined the Fabian Society, as that appeared to be somewhat in the middle. Started turning up to more Birmingham Fabian Society things, learning things via their meetings, eventually being vice chair and for a time chair as well, although I maintain that was by turning up and not necessarily through any aptitude. Yeah, just slowly got more involved, really. And because of Twitter, I also went and campaigned in areas that weren't Hall Green as well. So, you know, I got friendly with Kerry McCarthy, who is the MP in Bristol East. Now, I believe, Shadow Secretary of State at DEFRA. And, you know, I went to campaign for her because there was a particularly poisonous Tory Twitter campaign against her. Because she was an active female MP on Twitter. So a few of us were like, yeah, we're going to go and campaign for Kerry McCarthy. We'll show those stupid Tories. So went to campaign for her, went to campaign with Sylvia Hill in Hales Owen, went to campaign for Tristram Hunt before he was elected. So that was my first experience of, you know, really feeling BNP on the doorstep. So I was quite, like, enterprising, really. But, you know, obviously slowly got more, you know, involved in, you know, more grounded in Birmingham campaigning, and so obviously now most of my voter ID and door knocking and leafleting and all of that is cemented either in Hall Green or Yardley for the most part. And yeah.
Okay, so May 2014,
mm-hmm.
you get elected.
Yeah.
And off you toddle to the Birmingham City Council.
Yep.
To say, hold it.
Absurdly, you know, shortly afterwards, I should say. Like,
yeah.
It's like next morning. It's like you get like a really cool spy-like envelope that says only to be opened in the event of your election, which I was really excited about. And then it's like, yay, well done you. By the way, be at Council House 10 a.m. to have your photo taken and to swear in. You're like, what? It's like, what? I'm going to look
awful. So what was that like then? Talk me through it.
The way I described it when I got back is it was like enrolling at college again, and not just because you get a weird little city council branded like bag, which I still haven't used because it's small and strange, but it is, you like, you're going into this place which is a building that doesn't look like people work in it. You know, it's very grand, and you go in and there are people who you recognise. You know, like Bobby Alden was there in the room and he went, oh, congratulations on your win. And it was like, oh, my mate went to uni with you and no stories about you, but you're just kind of like, thank you. And so it's all very, like, really odd. And then you go into a room with the chief executive, who was then also quite new, I think. It was like in the early days of Mark Rogers's ascension. And you know, you can't just read the statement of, you know, all the things you're going to do and uphold and being a good corporate parent. You have to read it out to him and then sign it in front of him. So it was all very...
So had you seen that document before you actually read it out and signed it?
Nope. Good thing I agreed with it, I suppose. It's on my wall at home, so I can go and check every so often that it's still...
Could you have amended it and said, no, actually, I don't agree with this bit, but I'm happy to uphold this bit?
I can't imagine they would have been massively pleased about that. To be honest, it was reasonably uncontroversial stuff about being, you know, it's like Nolan principles sort of stuff about being, you know, honest and open and giving good account of the city and being a good corporate parent, which was, I think, a recent addition given the city's, you know, record with children's services. It was a strange thing, and people referring to you as councillor, although you do get used to it, was also very strange. Like, I really thought, like, I was like, what? It's so over formal. I feel really like, just call me Claire, it's fine. But I have now come to realise that they also do it because they can't remember your name, which I have a lot more sympathy for. So instead of kind of going, don't worry, just call me my first name. Like, if they want to call me councillor because they've forgotten who I am, I'm like, I'm pretty cool with that because there are lots of us and I don't expect them to remember everybody. So, yeah, you get used to it, but it's odd. And yeah, as I say, I can only compare it to first day at college.
I mean, did you have any ambitions yourself at 2014? Did you think, hold it, yeah, actually, I think, given my track record of working in Moseley, in sustainable Moseley, bringing on projects, working with other partners in the city, I've got something to offer here. Did you have an ambition?
No, I mean, not really. I mean, I believe that while I'm doing this and while, you know, in my term when, you know, I'm lucky enough to have been elected, it's the right thing that I should try and be the best me, the best councillor Claire Spencer I can be. And but I know that, there's so much you can know about local government. There are so many ways you could specialise, even as a member who is supposed to be much more of a generalist. You know, you're not supposed to be the one delivering the service, but, you know, you can go into detail. You could join innumerable committees and initiatives and projects. You know, if it's not a full-time job for you, it could easily be. You know, you can fill your time and time over. You know, all the things I would love to be involved in if I didn't have to pay bills and, you know, and what have you. But
on a personal level, so let's say, you know, May 2014,
mm-hmm.
you have a job.
Yeah.
Is it a full-time job?
I It was a 4-day-a-week job when I took it on. Rather, you know, annoyingly, I lost a job at the end of 2013. So I was in the position of looking for a job and trying to get elected and also buying a house, which was like really unpleasant as an overlapping of life events.
I'd like to ask you a couple of questions now about the role that you have in council and how you manage to do the job of working, being a councillor, and all the demands that that brings upon you.
Yeah.
And if we kind of break that down, perhaps what I can say is you do 3 days a week in your real job.
Yep.
And then your elected position takes up pretty much the rest of your time, which in reality for most people would be, in some cases if you were doing it properly, almost a full-time job. Is that right?
Yeah, I think it. I'm not saying you can't do it well in less than full-time, because you can, you know, demonstrably some people work smarter than others and can get things done faster, but it is, I find it really hard to imagine how you could work full-time and get everything done, because, you know, I find even staying on top of the admin, and I don't know if it's just that because I favour to work in email because I like to leave a paper trail and I like to, you know, be able to set Outlook reminders so I don't forget to do things, you know, maybe because I lead with email, I get more email in return, but it means that getting your casework and your admin and all your reading done, you know, that takes a huge amount of time in its own right, and that's only really one part of being a councillor. You know, there's also the very sort of the public facing person who goes to neighbourhood forums and stands smiling glibly at events, which, you know, obviously certain colleagues do more of than others, I would say. But and then there's the, you know, the Change the World councillor who says, you know, this service doesn't work properly and I'm going to make this council work better and we're going to be great at partnership and we're going to do this much better. But that, again, is a very different set of skills and use of time. And actually, all three of those really don't sit massively comfortably with one another if you also have a job. So you have to choose, you know, and on the days when I think, you know, oh, I'm involved in something really cool that is changing how the council works, actually, you know, inevitably your admin has slipped, you know, and if you're up on your admin, then you might not have been out in the ward for 3 days, you know, apart from that I live in my ward, obviously, so at least I'm catching buses and walking down the high street, and so we'll see it in that general sense, even if I haven't gone to a thing per se. But it bothers you, though, because it's like, well, I know it's important to do my casework and I don't have to just do stuff that is publicly visible. You know, I can't take a selfie of myself helping someone with a personal independence payments, you know, appeal, for example. You know, that's not a thing. But also, I, you know, you worry that, you know, like people might think you're not working hard enough if they don't see you. So you do, you agonise over this about what's the right balance. And, you know, the answer is, you know, it's, there's no answer really. I think you have to do a bit of everything and you have to try to make it work, and you won't always get the balance right, but mostly people are not monsters and generally understand that it is a hard thing to do.
Well, given that today is the 9th of November and it's the closure of the nominations for the leadership, it would be remiss of me in the extreme if I was not to discuss a couple of things that arise out of that.
Oh, it would.
So I'm sure you'll be happy to share with us your views.
Yeah.
So a couple of things. Mm-hmm. We have at the moment 5 candidates.
Yes.
We have 4 men, John Clancy, Dr. Barry Henley, Mike Leddy, Deputy Leader Ian Ward, and entering at the very last point, we have Councillor Penny Holbrook. Now, I think it's, you know, not exactly a secret. I think you've said it earlier on that you wanted to see a woman enter the campaign.
Yeah.
And we now have Councillor Penny Holbrook entering.
We do.
and I'm presuming that you will be supporting her.
Yes, well, on her blog today, I am in fact the first guest blogger that she's got on her blog, and I've blogged specifically about, you know, the Kerslake Review's prescription of partnership, and how Penny has already walked the walk on partnership, both as Erdington District Chair and more latterly in her cabinet role. So yeah, I mean, I did very much want there to be women in the race, but not, I mean, I think for its own sake is important, but also because the women who I wanted to enter are strong candidates who are worthy of being in there. And I felt that we were being deprived of choosing between the best candidates if we did not have at least one of those women. And, you know, thankfully we have got one of them, you know, which I'm really, you know, I'm pleased about. It's really tricky in leadership elections because you want to say to people that you can still think highly of them but not want them to be leader of the city, and that you still think that they're talented and insightful but prefer somebody else. And that's, I mean, it's not an easy thing to say to somebody.
We had a lovely conversation going down to London for a demonstration, I think, a couple of years ago.
We did.
And you confessed that you were an early supporter of Mr. Miliband.
Oh, I'm still not.
And you're on record as saying, I think, that you thought yourself as a One Nation Labour person.
Yeah.
Are you still there?
I did really rate Ed, and I liked that he was thoughtful. I liked that he was willing to go where people were. I liked that evidence seemed to figure in the way that he made policy. And I liked how much, and in the Q&A format, which is where I first saw a lot, like I went to see him at Latitude Festival, he was being interviewed by Franny Armstrong, who directed The Age of Stupid, which is a climate change film with Pete Postlethwaite in, but she interviewed him. And he's got such a nice way with him when he's in a room of people, and has a sort of fondness for people, which you can see in person, that not every politician has, with massive regret that is not so obvious when you see him on TV. And I think by the time people got to see more of the side that I thought I could see, it was too late. I don't know.
So where are you in the party at the moment?
I don't know. Well, the party seems to have moved around me to a significant extent. I always think in my brain that I'm quite left-wing. But I also know that I'm pragmatic. I know that, you know, things exist on a spectrum, that not everybody, we don't live in a world of Claire Spencers. You know, we live in a world where people hold, quite comfortably hold, conflicting ideologies inside themselves and neither know nor care that this is the case. And I think this is deeply political. People struggle with this because they assume that someone must exist on this spectrum. It's like, no, they don't. You know, they will happily pick two views. They will love rail nationalisation and, you know, hate inheritance tax, and, you know, will maybe love immigration but hate gay people. You know, it's completely conceivable that this human could exist, and many of them do, and people really struggle with it. And I'm a great believer in living in the world that you've got, and sometimes you have to be pragmatic. And I think the problem I've had with some other pragmatists is that you forget that you can't just compromise all the time. You have to compromise for something and from somewhere, and people who are values, who do think they have a consistent ideology and do have a way of seeing the world, they need to see that that's there, you know. And that's why one of the reasons Jeremy Corbyn has done so well is that he's got a very consistent values base and seems to have acted fairly consistently on that for many, many years, and speaks about it in a very measured and calm and collegiate way. And I can see why that appeals to people. I'm not saying that I'm not worried about the compromise half of it, but actually you can't have compromise without that, you know, just as you can't have that without compromise if you're going to win an election. But, you know, given that we might not have won the election with the other lot who were standing anyway, I don't feel anyone can be particularly more alarmed about Jeremy Corbyn than you could be about Andy Burnham.
Councillor Spencer, can I thank you very much indeed for speaking to Labour Lives this evening?
You're welcome.